All right, good evening, everybody, and welcome. I'm Rebecca Johnson. I'm co-president of the League of Women Voters of Bellingham and Whatcom County. If everyone would please stand now and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, with justice, and justice for all. All right, and before we get started, if everyone would please take a quick moment and make sure your cell phones are off. That would be great. Thank you. The voter forums are presented by the League of Women Voters of Bellingham and Whatcom County and the City of Bellingham. The city has provided the facilities, and the forum is being telecast live on BTV10, and the forums will also be repeated on BTV10, the city's YouTube channel, and on low-powered radio stations KMRE and KAVZ. And the Bellingham Herald is our media partner. We thank all of these partners for their generous support, and if you have the opportunity, we hope you'll thank them as well. Founded in 1920, the League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan organization with 800 affiliates across the country. It encourages informed and active participation in government, works to increase understanding of major public policy issue, and influence public policy through education and advocacy. Membership is open to men and women of all age, at age 16 and older, and we invite you all to join. Tonight is the second of three forums produced this fall by the League of Women Voters of Bellingham, Whatcom County. We'll be covering the contested races for the 42nd Senate race and the two 40th District representative positions. Next Saturday, we're going to be presenting the pro and con debates on three statewide ballot measures: Initiative 732, the carbon consumption tax; Initiative 1433, Raise Up Washington; and Initiative 1464, Government Accountability. The forums are the property of the League of Women Voters of Bellingham and Whatcom County and the City of Bellingham, and may not be used in any manner without specific permission from both parties. If you would like to get information, more information about the ballot measures, all of the ballot measures have summaries listed on the League of Women Voters Washington webpage, so that's LWVBWC.org. And now I would like to introduce our moderator, League member Amory Peck.
Thank you, Rebecca, and good evening, everyone. We're starting tonight with the 40th Legislative District's Senate race. I'd like to introduce the candidates, Daniel Miller and Kevin Ranker. Thank you. The Washington Legislature is called upon to enact or reject legislation affecting public policy in the state, provide for the levy and collection of taxes and other revenue to support state government and assist local government, and appropriate funds for these purposes. The Senate also has the exclusive power to confirm certain gubernatorial appointments. Although laws are enacted only when the legislature is convened in formal session, policy issues and the general operation of state and local government are under continuous review by legislators serving on permanent and interim study committees. Washington State senators serve four-year terms, and their annual salary is $46,839. Before we begin tonight, the rules for the forum are: candidates, you'll have 1 minute each for an opening statement. You will then have 1 minute to respond to each question, and we'll each make a one-minute closing statement. New this year, each one of the candidates has a challenge card. Can you show me your challenge cards? Thank you. Candidates may use this card to challenge or rebut their opponent's responses. The challenging candidate will have 45 seconds to state the challenge, and his opponent will have 45 seconds to respond to the challenge. Each candidate may use their challenge cards two times during the question and answer period. Candidates, simply hold up your card when you wish to challenge your opponent on a particular question, and I'll call on you. We have timers this evening. Riley Abel and Carol Como are seated down here in front. You need to know where they are, and they'll be tracking the time. Carol will flash a yellow sign when 15 seconds remain, and a red sign to signal time is up. If a candidate continues, a bell will be rung, and that's your signal to stop talking.
And then the taser.
Yes. We ask that the candidates be respectful of the time allotted due to the limited amount of time that we have and our desire to include as many questions as possible. To the audience, an important goal of the League is civil discussion. To that end, we ask that those in the audience be respectful and refrain from comments, as well as hold your applause until the conclusion of each segment of the forum. We encourage you to, as members of the audience, to provide written questions for the candidates. Questions should be addressed to both candidates, and they should be directed at policies that are important to this race. Ushers are available to pick up your questions and bring them to the screeners at the table to our right. So, runners, where are you? These people will pick up your questions and they will come here to the screeners. The screeners tonight are Joe Collins, Judy Hopkinson, and Jill Bernstein, and they're screening for eligibility and clarity and to sort out duplication. To start us off, the candidates rolled dice. They had a tie the first time. The second time around, the high roller had the choice of either going first with opening statement or giving the closing statement. After that choice of order, I'll rotate back and forth. The winner of the dice roll the second time was candidate Miller, and his choice was to do the closing statement, the last statement. So that means candidate Ranker, we'll start with you. Your 1 minute opening, please.
I want to start by thanking everyone for coming out tonight, and particularly thanking the League for hosting this and for all the just incredible work you do in so many communities around the state and the country. It's an incredible organization, and for those of you that aren't more familiar with it, please do get involved. I've been in the Senate for 8 years, which is actually kind of shocking to me. When I got started, I didn't know if I'd be here for 8 years or longer. But during that 8 years, I found that we were able to do some incredible things. We were able to pass full marriage equality in this state, giving every loving couple the right to marry. We were able to create one of the strongest oil spills preparedness and response programs in the country here in Washington State. And we also, however, have a lot of work to do. On the oil spills, our oil transportation has totally changed. There's some things we need to correct. We also need to fully fund our schools, and we have not done that. And I hope that we can have a greater conversation about that during this debate.
I, too, want to thank the Women's League of Voters. And this is really a, you know, nice ambiance here tonight. I love this. Reminds me of a courtroom. You're the jury, and you decide whether we win the court case or lose the court case. And, of course, the campaign is the court case. I'm running for the state legislature because I think at this time, in this juncture, I'm the best one suited for this job. I want to bring better representation to the 40th district. I'm concerned about hospital issues, healthcare issues, water rights, property rights, but mainly jobs. I want to work on jobs. I'm not God's greatest job creator like Donald Trump, but I believe I'll be okay with jobs, and I'll work on both sides of the aisle on jobs. This election, both Hillary and Donald Trump say this is an important election. Thank you.
Candidate Miller, we'll start with you with the first question.
Okay, fantastic.
What measures should our legislature take to comply with the McClary decision that requires the state to fully fund our schools by 2018? What funding options would you support to accomplish this?
First, I want to say, if I get elected, I have no doubt within the next 2 years, the McClary decision will be taken care of. But I also want to add real quick, we need to fully fund hospitals and address the nurses shortage, just like the education shortage. There's money out there. There's money hidden away in different pockets. There's different corners we can cut. I have no doubt that we'll find the money. I'll work with Republicans, Democrats, Independents, and the money will be found. I just read today that one of the senators is really excited because there's apparently $334 million for schools that they found. And it's being championed that this money can go towards the McCleary decision in 2017-18. So $334 million is what some senators are kicking around as money that's been found. Thank you.
Candidate Ranker. What measures should our legislature take to comply with the McCleary decision that requires the state to fully fund our schools by 2018? What funding options would you support to accomplish this?
So let's get specifically into the measures and what funding options in about 15 seconds. Let me state first that I don't know where this $340 million is, but I will say this. During the Great Recession in Washington State, we didn't just cut the fat out of many critical programs for our communities, we cut to the bone. We devastated higher education. We devastated mental health. McCleary is not the only Supreme Court lawsuit that has been rightfully thrown in our lap. We have maybe there's 340 buried somewhere that I haven't found yet. It's the number two Democrat on the Ways and Means Committee writing the budget. But what I can tell you is the minimum allocation to fully fund our schools, the very bare minimum, is $3.5 billion. And we have a bipartisan agreement on that. To get to the point, I wasted 45 seconds on that, and now five saying that. There are a number, basically we need to turn our entire tax structure on its head. We need to be willing to put everything on the table and have a thoughtful and bold conversation about how we find new revenue to fully fund our schools.
Thank you. And candidate Ranker, I'll have you lead off this time. There are a number of statewide initiatives on the ballot this November. What does this tell us about how well the legislature deals with the issues of major concern?
So let me back up. There's some initiatives that were on the ballot previously that we still haven't implemented. We have an initiative that passed overwhelmingly by the citizens for smaller class sizes in our schools, which is critical, particularly in K-3. We know that children learn better when there's less kids in the classroom because the teacher can provide more information. We haven't been able to get our job done in doing these. And the reason, first of all, the initiative process, I think, is a wonderful process because it allows individual citizens to bring forward ideas. But what it says about the legislature is we need to step up. We don't just need to fully fund education. We need to fully fund critical mental health programs. We need to fully fund some of our other social safety net programs. And to do that, we need to stop taking these stupid oaths that say, I will never raise taxes ever. What we need to do is have a thoughtful conversation about how we can reform our tax structure, because we have the single most regressive tax structure in the entire country right here in Washington State. That means the poorest people who can afford it the least are paying the most.
Thank you. Do you need the question again?
That would be nice, thank you. Okay.
There are a number of statewide initiatives on the ballot this November. What does this tell us about how well the legislature deals with issues of major concern?
That is true. The state, Senate, and the state legislature need to step up on certain issues. But the initiative system allows people in the public, people in nonprofits, to come up with ideas and hopefully get them on the ballot. So that's, you know, it's kind of a direct democracy. So the legislature should step up, but I think we should keep the initiative process. Having said that, there are initiatives that are not good. There are initiatives that are bad for the state of Washington. So the initiative process is a double-edged sword, but even if the legislature steps up, I believe the people in the state of Washington are still going to want to retain the initiative process. Thank you.
Candidate Miller. In mid-September, the State Department of Ecology announced limits on carbon emissions from certain industries and utilities to combat climate change. Many are located in the 40th District. How do you view this action?
All right. I'm sorry, can you repeat the question one more time?
In mid-September, the State Department of Ecology announced limits on carbon emissions from certain industries and utilities to combat climate change. Many are located in the 40th District. How do you view this action?
Well, plain and simple, for example, on coal, there's technology out there to make coal trains run safer and coal burning safer. I believe that we should not impose restrictions on job-killing restrictions on the citizens of the state of Washington. There's technologies and different things we can do to make, like I say, coal run safer. And these job killers are creating poverty in the state of Washington. They're, you know, wrecking families, all in the name of global warming. And so we need to have a debate on global warming. But we need, before we put technology, you know, restrictions on jobs, we need to use some of these technologies. We need to, it's very complicated, but we need to retain jobs and not junk science. Not all science is junk, but, okay.
Candidate Ranker, would you like to challenge or to answer the question?
Both.
I'll answer the question. I'll save the challenge.
Okay.
So I'm extremely familiar with the rulemaking process that the governor asked Department of Ecology to do, and I think it's a really good idea. We have to put a firm cap on pollution in Washington State, and we need to make sure the polluters actually pay. Yes, some of the jobs, some of the industries that support thousands of jobs in the 40th District and the 42nd District would be impacted by this, but that is why the rule was revised. The rule was first implemented or released months ago, and they brought it back after taking input from Puget Sound Energy, the refineries, and many others, and they brought it out in a more thoughtful manner. But we have got to take a step on climate change and take firm action on climate change. We are the first generation that has experienced the impacts of climate change, and we are the last generation that is going to be able to do anything about it. It is our duty and our absolute duty to step up and do this, not just for the environment, but for the health of our citizens and our communities.
Okay. Thank you. Candidate Ranker, the fishing and shellfish industries have suffered dramatic reduction in recent years. What measures do you propose to restore them to health?
Just yesterday, I spent the entire afternoon on the Skagit at the Fur Island restoration site that WDFW, Washington State Department of Fish and Wildlife, and EPA and some others have been working on for years. It's been a collaborative effort bringing farmers and fishermen and others together for a salmon restoration project. We have a multi-billion dollar price tag on restoring Puget Sound, and by restoring Puget Sound, we don't just get healthy fish populations, which I love to go catch, but we also get a healthier sound, and a healthy marine ecosystem creates a healthy economy and creates a healthy community surrounding it. So what I believe we must do is take a serious look at the steps that must be taken to follow models and replicate them like Fur Island, but also we need to start dealing with stormwater and some of the other massive impacts to not just the Puget Sound, but the Straits of Juan de Fuca, the Columbia River watershed entirely, and the open ocean coast.
Thank you. Candidate Miller, the fishing and shellfish industries have suffered dramatic reductions in recent years. What measures do you propose to restore them to health?
Well, that is true. And first, let me say, before I talk about proposals, we need to restore them to health. We have a legislator also here who is concerned about the shellfish industry of their tribes. And whether you're in Indian tribes or not, the shellfish industry must thrive. Out on San Juan Island, there was the oyster farm. So basically, we just need to, you know, work on ways to make sure our water is healthy, and using technology. Once again, I go back to the fact that we cannot impose killing thousands of jobs without first using technology, killing thousands of jobs in the state of Washington, in the name of global warming. A lot of these regulations are going to cause poverty. No. They're going to make people have a real hard time. And thank you.
I do have a challenge on that one.
Okay. You have 45 seconds to express your challenge.
Thank you. Dealing with climate change is not a job killer. In fact, it's a job creator. There are resource jobs that can be created, but also let's take the shellfish industry. Taylor Shellfish moved a few hundred jobs from Washington State to Hawaii. Why? Because we have more acidic waters, which are directly caused by carbon inputs into the ocean. Dealing with ocean acidification is a great way to not only keep jobs here, but create new jobs. There is a vast amount of information supporting this, and what we need to do is step up and realize that it's not the environment versus jobs, it's the environment creates jobs.
And you have 45 seconds to respond.
In my voter's guide, you will see that I have talked about the acidification of oceans and want to work on the acidification of oceans with scientists. So I am addressing clean oceans and clean water throughout this campaign. But also, I think we need to, I always go like this because I have a feeling people can't hear, but maybe they can.
I think they can.
Also, when we talk about global warming, we have to talk about geoengineering, we have to talk about climate modification. We have to talk research people like Clifford Carnicom, Dane Wigington out of Mount Shasta. And so global warming is really complicated. And you know, there's a case that maybe global warming's not true, but still these geoengineering programs are true. Thank you.
Now we have a question that came from someone in the audience, and we'll start with you, candidate Miller. Would you be willing to consider alternatives to timber sales to fund schools and hospitals? If so, what would you consider?
Well, timber sales are a legitimate way to fund education. They've done that since the beginning of the state, pretty much. But I do need to go back to the fact that there's money out there. The state has more money than it lets on. There's corners we can cut. Once again, it was a Democrat, not a Republican, who said we have $334 million for schools, and they were excited that this money would go towards schools. And so this is not coming from a Republican. This is coming from a Democrat that says money has been found, and they're excited that money has been found. Maybe we need more money. Also, there's a teacher in the room, which is my sister. So I care about education, and I can get feedback on educational issues. Thank you.
Candidate Ranker, would you be willing to consider alternatives to timber sales to fund schools and hospitals? If so, what would you consider?
Absolutely. And let me speak about the situation that we all know too well here with Blanchard Mountain. We have an incredible recreational resource, an incredible community resource on Blanchard Mountain. And the community has rallied to save it as a recreational and natural resource. And that is a potential serious impact to one of our local school districts. So how do you address that? You have to find other resources for our schools. And frankly, that goes back, and with hospitals as well, this goes back to the bigger discussion of our entire tax structure. We need to reform our tax structure so that we don't have these dying on the vine situations when we have too little revenue coming into the state, and frankly, too much money in the high times. We need a more stable and appropriate tax structure, and it's a much larger discussion that I can get to in the next 15 seconds. But what it's going to take is all of us, Democrats and Republicans, sitting down and being willing to say yes instead of no.
Thank you. And don't forget, if you have questions, send them forward, please. Candidate Ranker, how do you assess current efforts to meet the danger of accidents during the transport of volatile fuels through the 40th District and across the state? Is there legislation you would support to lessen the likelihood of future damaging events?
Thanks for the softball. yes, and we've already got it drafted, frankly. 2 years ago, many in this room, frankly, celebrated a bipartisan effort that was led by Senator Erickson to do legislation to protect us from oil trains. Some of that legislation in the end was still good. Most of it was gutted, and we shouldn't have celebrated. You know what was taken out of that bill? While we got some of the oil train legislation through for protection on the rails, any rail next to water was taken out of the bill. Any marine transport was taken out of the bill. The legislation I referenced in the very beginning of my opening statement about having the greatest oil spills preparedness and response program in the nation, that's old news. Oil has totally changed how it's transported in Washington State. It used to be all coming in tankers from the North Slope, and now a lot of it's coming by rail. We also have barges instead of tankers. What we have to do is implement new legislation that truly protects our communities and our environment from exploding oil trains and from vessel disasters.
Thank you. Candidate Miller, how do you assess current efforts to meet the danger of accidents during the transport of volatile fuels through the 40th District and across the state? Is there legislation you would support to lessen the likelihood of future damaging events?
Right. There is legislation I would support. We need to make sure that the trains are safe, make sure they're really safe. I see no reason why we can't allow oil trains to move about freely. That's part of our economy right now. You know, we drive cars, we drive airplanes. At this juncture, we need oil. But you might be surprised to say, there actually is things, alternative fuels. There's actually, there are alternative ways of transportation. Like, have you ever heard of who killed the electric car? So, in the meantime, while we work on developing some of these alternative fuels, let's keep the oil trains running, let's keep our economy strong, and no doubt we will find alternatives if we need them. Thank you.
Okay. Candidate Miller, what is your stand, or what has been your stand, on legislative efforts to change current non-discrimination policies for transgender people in our state?
Right. I've been traveling all day. I don't want to act like I'm stupid. Please repeat the question one more time. Thank you.
Okay. What is your stand, or what has been your stand, on legislative efforts to change current non-discrimination policies for transgender people in our state?
Okay, let's address it this way. It's a big issue whether 70-year-olds should take showers with 40-year-olds at the public gym. In education, in schools, right now, apparently, they're priming up to teach kindergartners, first graders, second graders, third graders about, you know, being gay, lesbian, and transgender. And then they have a book called Jazzy, which is about a transgender youth and their experiences and adventures. So here's the situation. I don't think we should teach kids in first grade, second grade, third grade, fourth grade about gay, lesbian, or transgender. And I think it's a slippery slope. And once again, this is really a big topic. It's just not only about that. It goes back to transgender showers, you know? Let's ask ourselves, if you want your 7-year-old to take a shower with me, this is not appropriate for kids to take showers with adults at the gym. Thank you.
Candidate Ranker, would you like to challenge or to answer the question?
So I actually do want to do both. I want to challenge a statement that my colleague made.
Okay, 45 seconds.
Never mind, mine turned off. I'll trust your timer. So as the son of two dads, I can tell you that lesbian, gay, transgender, I don't care, can be wonderful, loving parents, and no one should ever question that. Everybody in our society has the right to be treated with respect and dignity, and teaching that at a very young age is absolutely what our educational system is there for. It is our duty as educators, whether we are a teacher or just a citizen, to teach our children that treating others with respect and love is what really matters.
Okay, you have 45 seconds.
Yes, I do treat gay, lesbian, and transgender with respect. at Evergreen State College, where I got my BA in Public Policy and Environmental Studies. I probably shouldn't name names, but I can, of different people that, you know, they were my partners in some educational, you know, jobs that we had. You know, we were good friends. So I respect gay, lesbian, and transgender people. And so, but this is not really about respecting, in my view, gay, lesbian, and transgenders. You know, I don't think we should expose 5-, 6-, and 7-year-olds to that topic and have them read a book called Jazzy. Thank you.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I'm going to let him answer right now. What is your stand or what has been your stand on legislative efforts to change current non-discrimination policies for transgender people in our state?
I think the rulemaking that came down that said that transgender folks absolutely have the right to go into the bathroom that they identify with is absolutely what should happen and should stay in law, and it should not be challenged. I think that it is very clear that Washington voters agree with this. We will not discriminate. We are not a discriminatory state. And it's important to recognize that this is a societal issue that matters. It is one of the most core values on whether or not we treat each other with respect and dignity. And on the transgender issue, the initiative that was being filed was pure discrimination. And it's not about who's in the bathroom. It's about how we treat and respect each other in our communities. And I'll stop there.
Okay, thank you. Candidate Ranker. How will you help small businesses in the state of Washington and in our community?
Actually, it's interesting. There's a one of the proposals that has been discussed in the past. I actually had a bill for it 2 years ago. Anybody in small business hates B&O tax, our business and occupation tax. I hate it. I think it's stupid. I've got a proposal where 90% of small businesses in Washington State, and actually 90% of businesses in Washington State would pay no more B&O tax. And of the remaining 10%, 5 would see a decrease in their B&O tax, and the largest corporations could see an increase. We had the bill, I don't remember the number, sorry, 2 years ago. Some reform of B&O has to take place, and if we're going to reform our tax structure, we should do it in a way that helps Main Street and our small businesses, because they're the greatest employers in our state.
Thank you. Candidate Miller, how will you help small businesses in the state of Washington and in our community?
Well, first let me say I'll work with Democrats, Independents, and Republicans on job creation and keeping jobs in the state of Washington. One way we can do that is making sure that the gas tax doesn't get too high. We also can try, you know, I want to be on record to opposing a state income tax. I think that'll just create all kind of havoc in all kind of different ways. So there's many different ways we can help small business. We also want to make sure that we don't have job-killing regulations on small business. Like I said before, we can't put all these job-killing regulations on small business while at the same time creating poverty. I do also want to put it on record. I oppose the TPP. I'm not running for U.S. Senate. I'm running for state Senate. But I oppose the TPP and a lot of these trade agreements that are job killers. And I want to keep Boeing in the state of Washington and keep them from going to China. Thank you.
Okay, candidate Miller, what is your view about increasing the state's minimum wage?
Well, if I was working for minimum wage, which I've done before, I would want it to be $100 an hour. But I don't know if that will work right now. So we have to only look what's happening with Seattle. A lot, they're having $15 an hour. And some of the waiters and waitresses were kind of upset because the tips went down and people are moving out, you know, want to eat out of the jurisdiction of Seattle. We do have a minimum wage in the state of Washington, and which is a bit low. You know, maybe we can raise it a bit, but I think it's better to have jobs created right now than, you know, have a high minimum wage. We need jobs. We need more jobs. Americans in the state of Washington are concerned about their economy. And so there you have it.
Okay. Candidate Ranker, what is your view about increasing the state's minimum wage?
I think we should phase in an increase up to $15 an hour for a minimum wage in Washington State statewide. I believe that we can do that in a way that works. I also believe that, you know, I mean, during the Great Recession, hundreds of thousands of people lost their jobs. Many of them have gotten, have been reemployed, but they're underemployed. People went from good wages with full benefits to working part-time at box stores. And I think that we need to recognize that and really help people and give them a lift up. And one of the things government can do is look at increasing the minimum wage, and that's why I'm supportive of it.
Candidate Miller, do you want to use one of your challenges before the time is over? We're about to go to the last question.
I guess, can we go to the last question and then a challenge on global warming, or do I have to do that now?
Let's have to do that now.
Global warming.
Or shall we go ahead?
Well, let's ask the last question first, okay. And then we can...
We'll have this last question, then you'll each have your final statement. And let me see. Candidate Ranker, if elected, what legislation will you make a personal priority to pass because you believe it would most benefit the people of your district, and why do you choose it?
I've been working on some legislation for a while now looking at equal pay. I believe that the fact that a vast majority of women, particularly in state employment, but statewide, are receiving less wages for the exact same work is totally unacceptable. So I've been working with some colleagues of mine on a bill to try and address that. And frankly, one of the things we can do is start with our own state agencies and do a deep dive and look at if there are any women that are receiving less compensation than men for the same work with the same qualifications, we raise their wage. And I look forward to having that debate on the Senate floor and anybody who would challenge that.
Candidate Miller, if elected, what legislation would you make a personal priority to pass because you believe it would most benefit the people of your district, and why do you choose it?
I do have to say that I do, too, support equal pay for equal work. Of course, I would. I want to work on jobs. I want to work on hospitals. I want to work on the nursing shortage, which is at epidemic levels. I was at a nursing conference and was sitting around the round table and heard different horror stories of nurses being forced to work out of their scope of practice, being forced to work overtime without pay, and a lot of problems with overtime, with the nursing shortage. So I think the nursing shortage is something important, and I also want to look at medical malpractice. My grandmother received medical malpractice at the Everett Hospital, which was very devastating. So I want to work on jobs. I want to work on hospitals. I want to work on freedom and liberty, making sure money is well spent. You know, it's your tax dollars, it's not mine. And of course, schools and education. Thank you.
Candidate Ranker, your closing statement.
I want to, again, thank the league and thank everybody for coming out tonight. I also, Daniel, I want to thank you for running.
Thank you.
It's been a wonderful time, this last session with you. On the last question, very quickly, the legislation is critical. The other critical piece, and this is something for my closing statement, we must fully fund education. We must put a minimum of $3.5 billion more into K-12 education, and not because of the McCleary lawsuit, but because it's the right thing to do. We want our children to have the most wonderful school and educational opportunities they can. The other thing I would say is, since the Republicans took control of the Senate 3 years ago, we have lost touch with some of our dearest and most core values in Washington State. We have devastated some of the strongest environmental policies coming forward, and we have also looked at issues of equality with a slant, just in the wrong way. And particularly, I want to point out, there was a bill, Senate Bill 5927. A majority of the Republican senators sponsored this bill. It literally would have allowed discrimination, not just against LGBTQ members, but also pregnant women. We've got to get our core values back in our state.
And candidate Miller, your closing statement.
Well, I do want to thank Kevin Ranker for coming. I want to thank you all for coming out tonight on such a wintry night. I really didn't get a chance to talk about my background too much. I went to Evergreen State College, where I received a BA in public policy and environmental studies. I also attended the University of Washington Legal Studies some. I'm a small business owner. I own New England Collectibles up there in Friday Harbor, and I work on dementia care in the evening. So I'm involved in the nursing issue a bit. I want to work for a good economy here in our district, region, and state, freedom and liberty in our cities, towns, and countryside. There are many issues that are important that will come up at, you know, this next time. In closing, I just want to say, you're the jury. This is kind of like a trial, like Perry Mason. believe it or not, this election is very critical. Like I said earlier, both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump have mentioned how critical this election is. Thank you.
Please join me in thanking Daniel Miller and Kevin Ranker for being here tonight. And if our next two candidates could come forward, Sharlaine LaClair and Luanne Van Werven. Come on up.
Well, thank you. Thanks, man. Thanks for coming.
Okay, while they're settling in, let me give you a bit about the job they're running for. State representatives have the responsibility to propose and enact public policy, set a budget, and provide for the collection of taxes to support state and local government. We elect two representatives from each legislative district. Washington State representatives serve two-year terms, and their annual salary is $46,839. I'd like to introduce the candidates running for this position. They are Sharlaine LaClair and Luanne Van Werven. Same ground rules apply that you just saw. And want to remind those of you in the audience that you can provide questions to the candidates. They should be addressed to both candidates, and just raise your hand and someone will get your question up here. We'll begin with 1 minute opening statements. Since candidate LaClair won the dice toss and chose to close last, we'll start with candidate Van Werven.
Well, thank you for this evening. Thank you to the League and for those of you who are here this evening. My name is Luanne Van Werven, and I have spent most of my adult life encouraging others to get involved in the political and legislative process. And it has been a wonderful time of giving back to my community. And 2 years ago, when this position became available, I was humbled and surprised that people encouraged me to run. Because of my leadership, my experience, my roots in the community, I was encouraged to run for this office, and I did. And it has been the experience of a lifetime. I have poured myself into this job, and I serve on the appropriations, I serve on the state government committee, and I also serve on higher education. I have enjoyed these last 2 years. I feel like we have accomplished much, and I'm looking forward to going back for another 2 years so that we can continue to work on the big issues that matter in Washington State.
Thank you. And candidate LaClair, your opening statement.
Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Sharlaine LaClair, and I'm running for the Washington State Legislature. I'm a recent graduate of the Evergreen State College with my master's in public administration. I'm also a mother to a 9-year-old son who is here with us tonight and who I'm very proud of. He attends the Ferndale Public Schools, and I'm also a member of the Lummi Nation. I've been serving my local community since 2008 as a planning commissioner and a budget committee representative, making sure that we're looking out for the health, education, our judicial system, natural resource protection, and in my profession, I've been working on supporting entrepreneurship and small businesses. I decided to run because my elders have taught me a deep sense of responsibility to give back to our local communities. So I'm really interested on taking immediate action to fully fund our public schools, as well as working on job creation and increasing economic vitality for families to prosper here in Whatcom County.
First question will go to you, candidate LaClair. What single legislative act do you believe would do the most to help the agricultural community maintain and enhance its crucial value to our state, and why do you choose that option?
So water quality and water quantity issues are very important to address at the legislature. I really think that we need to pass legislation that requires not only the legislature to work together, but also to create a comprehensive plan to address issues that are affecting access to water and the quality of our water. To engage people in decision making is really important by involving the local agricultural community, the business community, our city and county council, as well as the different water districts that we have. I think that it's really important for us all to find ways to work together to create viable solutions that actually work and help our thriving agricultural community to continue to thrive while also protecting water on behalf of all of our residents and for harvesting of the Salish Sea. Thank you.
And candidate Van Werven, the same question. What single legislative act do you believe would do the most to help the agricultural community maintain and enhance its crucial value to our state, and why do you choose that option?
Agriculture is one of the most important industries in the state of Washington. Currently, it is number two when it comes to exports, and so we need to do what we can to protect and to enhance the agriculture community. I think one of the biggest problems that we have that I would like to see us work on as a legislature is there is a confusing network of regulations that is involved in the whole agriculture community. When the legislature passes a law, it's handed over to an agency and they usually have the rulemaking authority. Well, what I think we should do is to be able to have a review of those, of all the laws that are passed, and decide was that the intent of the legislature or not. And I know that Representative Bies in the Ag Committee is leading the way on having that kind of oversight of the agencies. And I think it's really important that they know that they are, the agencies know that they are following the intent of the bills.
Thank you. I'll start with you this time, candidate Van Werven. Both of you have worked with teens and young adults, including those at risk. What is the greatest challenge you believe our youth face? If elected, what legislative solution would you propose to help them meet it?
Our youth are the greatest asset that we have. I have a motto, it's always be looking to put yourself out of a job. That's my personal motto. And so I take the responsibility of leading that younger generation and pointing them in the way that they would be the great leaders of tomorrow. There is lots of opportunities that we have to pour ourselves into their lives. I think it's important that we point to programs and to opportunities, strengthening the families, whatever we can do to make their youth to be as so that they could be as strong as possible. I think there are many programs that we worked on in the legislature, and it's important that we continue to focus on youth and opportunities that they have to be the best that they can be.
Candidate LaClair, both of you have worked with teens and young adults, including those at risk. What is the greatest challenge you believe our youth face? If elected, what legislative solution would you propose to help them meet it?
Well, in my particular community, and I think that in other communities as well, I think that substance abuse has become a very big problem that needs to be addressed in a larger way. I think that we need to do more prevention. One of the things that I got to do as a young person was to do peer education to help as a young person to learn about the dangers and effects of substance abuse in the local community and to support one another as peers to make the right choices. I think that those type of programs that are peer-based and peer-led and are truly empowering for the young people are very important to support. And I think that we need to do a better job from a public health perspective of empowering young people to create, working on creating healthier, stronger communities. Because like she said, they are our strongest asset.
Candidate Claire, following up on that, heroin use has become a huge problem in Washington schools, high schools, and here in this community. What would you do to address this epidemic?
I think that there are underlying issues that impact substance abuse. I was talking with a colleague today about ACEs, the adverse childhood experiences, and things that young people and people in general go through in their families, and how much that impacts and puts people at risk for things like depression and domestic violence and problems in their family. And I think that we really need to fund mental health care and so that people have access to services to help overcome some of the issues that they're having a hard time with. Furthermore, we need to also work on rebuilding our economy and providing family wage jobs so that, because I think intergenerational poverty has a big impact on substance abuse issues, and we need to provide opportunities on the continuum from healing to prosperity. And that's something that I have a lot of experience with in my local community, and I would love to bring it to the legislature.
Candidate Van Werven, heroin usage has become a huge problem in high schools and Washington as a whole. What would you do to address this epidemic?
I think the answer is in strengthening our families. One of the pieces of legislation we passed this year is called Parent to Parent, and it allows for parents with strong families to be able to mentor struggling parents. And I think that education is key so that students understand the despair that drug use brings. And I think that we, the state legislature, would be far better ahead spending money on strengthening families and relying on our local nonprofits, faith-based nonprofits, to come alongside parents who are struggling in order to take care of some of these deep, intense needs. It really does come back to the families, a strong family, and I think that that's where we need to focus our resources.
Okay. Candidate Van Worden. In mid-September, the State Department of Ecology announced limits on carbon emissions from certain industries to mitigate the effects of climate change. Many are in Whatcom County. How do you view this action?
First, I want to make it very clear that Washington has made great strides in carbon emissions. We are one of the lowest carbon emitters in the United States, and we have made great strides in that direction. In particular, the 42nd District industries have spent millions in order to reduce the carbon emissions. And I think that people assume that that industry or jobs and a clean environment don't work well together, but nothing could be further from the truth. I've seen the commitment of these industries out at Cherry Point in particular, and they have a vested interest in a clean economy or in a clean environment. And I know the efforts that they have made in order to do that. And I think we continue to encourage them along those lines and believe that that these heavy-handed policies that have come down really are to the detriment of our family wage jobs in Whatcom County.
In mid-September, the State Department of Ecology announced limits on carbon emissions from certain industries to mitigate the effects of climate change. Candidate LaClair, many of these are in Whatcom County. How do you view this action?
I think that it's a step in the right direction. I think that we definitely need to continue to protect our environment for future generations. I think that we need to, you know, recognize that climate change is real, and we have to do our part to make sure that we are doing the best that we can to protect our land, our air, and our waterways. You know, if there are industries that are doing a great job, then I think that maybe if they're doing such a great job as they are, that they won't necessarily be negatively or adversely impacted. I think that it's important to, you know, when you're passing things, to talk with these businesses and job creators about how this will potentially impact them, and to find common ground and common sense solutions so that we are doing the right thing on behalf of our future generations. Thank you.
Okay, still with you, candidate LaClair. What steps would you take to make sure that those with mental illness get help before any harm is done to themselves or others? And do you support Initiative 1491?
Yes, I do support it. I think that it's important to protect the safety of our communities. We've saw the devastation that mass shootings have had. I think it's very sad when things like this can be prevented by having family members or professionals have the ability to report when somebody is in danger of harming themselves or others. I heard a concern that, if somebody has a vendetta against another person, that maybe they'll be able to report and have a gun taken away from them. But the reality is that there are stringent requirements about how this process takes. It goes in front of a judge to consider the request, so there has to be strong enough evidence to prove that this person is a danger to themselves or others. So I support protecting the safety of our communities.
Candidate Van Werven, what steps would you take to make sure that those with mental illness get help before any harm is done to themselves or others? And do you support Initiative 1491?
Working in the legislature the last 2 years, we have focused a lot on mental health and providing solutions for this issue. And I'm proud of the work that we have done and the progress that we have made. One bill in particular that I believe it was unanimous off the House floor and probably even the Senate, that was Joel's Law. And that was a law that was passed to provide parents or family members with the opportunity to go into a home if someone was a family member was at risk of hurting themselves or others, that there would be involuntary commitment. And that is a step in the right direction. I'm afraid that the initiative, though, violates due process in that those rights can be taken away before a individual is even convicted. And that on its face is unconstitutional and a violation of due process. So I don't support that.
Thank you. Continuing with you, candidate Van Werven. For 3 years, the legislature has discussed, but not resolved, differences in how to meet the Supreme Court's ruling that requires the state to fully fund education. What do you believe is necessary to arrive at a consensus?
I think it's important to point out the progress that has been made. In the last 4 years, we have increased K-12 education funding by $4.8 billion. That's a 36% increase. As a matter of fact, a recent study showed that Washington State is leading all other states in education funding for K-12. We made great progress in smaller class sizes for K-3. But I fully admit that more needs to be done. But I also think that the funding, any funding that we send towards K-12 has to be matched with reforms, because all of the money in the world isn't going to fix our education system if we don't have the ability to reform the system and make sure that every child has a chance to succeed. So much progress has been made, and I am proud of that. More needs to be done, and I think that we have the opportunity to do that. It may take a little longer than what the Supreme Court would like, but we have a plan, and we're working in that direction.
Thank you. Candidate LaClair, for 3 years, the legislature has discussed but not resolved differences in how to meet the Supreme Court's ruling that requires the state to fully fund education. What do you believe is necessary to arrive at a consensus?
Well, Representative Van Werven has said that progress has been made on fully funding the schools. I think it's important for the voters to know that the legislature is still being fined $100,000 a day because the court feels that they're not making quick enough progress on it. We need to take immediate action to fully fund the schools. One of the things we need to do is to reduce reliance on local levies, because when we do that, it doesn't create equities for, the wealthier communities have more to help fill the gap, while the poorer communities are left with critical, unmet needs. And we really have to address this. One of the ways to do that is, I think, as Senator Ranker discussed, addressing tax reform and the tax structure in our community so that all people are fairly and equally participating in our tax system. I have a challenge also.
Okay. Yes, would you like to do your challenge?
Yeah, thank you. So Luanne has said that we have, so that they have taken important steps and strides towards fully funding our schools, but I would like to know more about her voting record and if she could indicate specific bills that she has voted in favor of, because when I do research on her her voting record, you know, she's voted against implementing strategies to close the educational opportunity gap, against, you know, making sure kids have a meal at school, providing co-pays for student lunches, and against improving educational outcomes for homeless students, increasing guidance supports, housing stability, and identification of services. So I want to know what particular she has done to support education.
Well, you have 45 seconds to respond.
And that's a lot to answer in 45 seconds. So I will just go back to the fact that our last budget increased K-12 education. And over the, while I wasn't there 4 years ago, this last 2 years, I voted for the budget that did increase education spending K-12. In addition to that, in our capital budget, that is where we provided for smaller class size for building structures for K through 3. And so I stand on my record that I have been part of the solution and not part of the problem.
Thank you. I think it's your turn to lead off. Should the state minimum wage be raised?
So the state minimum wage in Washington state is the seventh highest in the nation. And currently it is well over $7 an hour. But studies show that an increased minimum wage does not reduce poverty or bring people low, and it hurts the low-income people the most. And I don't know why we can't focus on a broader range of solutions. One of the greatest way to bring people out of poverty is with a four-year degree. So why aren't we not focusing on access and opportunity and affordable higher education and other options as well that give our young people and our lower income people the best chance at success? And I believe that it goes well beyond just minimum wage when it shows that that is going to hurt the people that we want to help the most.
Candidate LaClair, should the state minimum wage be raised?
Yes, I support incremental changes to the state minimum wage so that it's increasing over time so that we can increase prosperity for families. I, for one, grew up in a single parent home where it was very difficult to make ends meet. My mom was a very proud person, and we did not rely on any programs to help us out, but that made it very difficult to get by. And I think that if there were a better minimum wage, then we could have prospered more as a family and had more opportunities. I know the value of education because I've received my master's degree, and that has been provided tremendous opportunities to me. But at the same time, while I support the minimum wage, we also have to take a look at need-based programs and assistance in the state so that we're not creating hardships for families in terms of looking at the income limits for food assistance or subsidized housing. I think we have to make those changes in tandem.
Okay. I'll stay with you, candidate LaClair. What steps would be important to improve water quality in our community?
So to improve water quality, I think that we need to, for one, update outdated infrastructure. So if there are outdated septic systems that are perhaps leaking into the streams and rivers, I think that we need to take a look at that. I think we need to continue to support businesses that are doing the right thing in terms of the agricultural community, that, you know, like having dairy digesters and buffers around the streams and, you know, lined manure lagoons or storage. I think that we need to continue to support best practices in the agricultural industry. But also, I think that we need to fund studies so that we know where the sources of pollution are happening, so we can target where the pollution is happening and to prevent it from further degrading habitat for salmon and shellfish beds.
Candidate Van Werven, what steps would be important to improve water quality in our community?
Water quality is essential for our quality of life here in Whatcom County. And I think we need a complete examination of all potential sources of contamination. Currently, there is a very confusing network of overlapping regulations that every sector has to deal with. And I think it's important that we stick with fact-based science and not get into agenda-driven policies. So I'll be working with a legislature in the next 2 years to be able to scale back some of these overlapping regulations so that we can provide for the best water quality and for the opportunities that we have for a clean and healthy community so that everybody has a chance to thrive.
Hey, thank you. Candidate Van Werven, do you support the growing of hemp in Washington?
Actually, I do. As a matter of fact, we had legislation this last year that allowed for research and study at the University of Washington. So I'll be interested to see what that pilot program, what that actually provides. And yes, I'm certainly open to that idea.
Thank you. Candidate LaClair, do you support the growing of hemp in Washington?
Yes, I do support the growing of hemp in Washington, and I think that it's really great that there's studies being done about the potential of how that can help grow our local economy and create jobs. I think that that's very necessary, especially here in Whatcom County in the 42nd District, to look at further opportunities for job creation and stimulating our local economy, as well as the potential for taxes that could help meet some of the very important needs that we have in the legislature.
Candidate LaClair, during the last session, a bill was introduced that would have permitted 16-year-olds to pre-register to vote, even though they can't exercise that right until they're 18. What are your thoughts on that proposal?
I think that that's a good idea. I think it's important to educate our young people and get them prepared to be active citizens in our local, state, and national elections, because their future really depends on it. I think if there are any efforts to increase the number of people that are coming to the polls and to get them ready for what that means to them, I think that that's a really great thing.
Thank you. Candidate Van Werven, during the last session, a bill was introduced that would have permitted 16-year-olds to pre-register to vote, even though they can't exercise that right until they turn 18. What's your view?
This is an example of how both sides came together for a compromise on an issue that was a little bit challenging. In particular, talking and working with the Secretary of State's office, the current database, voter database, is not equipped to hold those 16-year-old voter registrations in a separate file. So until then, what we are focused on is for currently the law does state that if you are going to be 18 by the time of the election, the next election, that you may register to vote. So what we're talking about is maybe a compromise would be for 17-year-olds in a citizenship class that they would have the opportunity to register to vote. But until we have a clear process of keeping those segregated, then it is not something that we could do at this time. But we'll look at it in the future.
Okay, thank you. This will be our last question before we go on to your final statements. Candidate Van Werver, if elected, what legislation would you make a personal priority to pass because you believe it would most benefit the people of your district, and why do you choose it?
One of the bills that I introduced this last year was it had the ability for students in technical college and community college to be able to know the price of textbooks and course materials at the time of registration. And I heard from so many students who were concerned about the high cost of textbooks and also course materials. And one of the most affordable ways that we can address higher education is for them to be able to have the opportunity to choose. So at the time of registration, maybe they can choose between a $200 textbook or a $50 textbook, but we want to be able to give them that choice. They also have the choice of going to online open resource materials. And so this bill did not pass because, unfortunately, textbook publishing companies were not in favor of it, but I plan to bring this bill back again this next session, and it had bipartisan support, and I appreciated that.
Okay, candidate LaClair, if elected, what legislation would you make your personal priority to pass because you believed it'd be the most benefit to people of your district, and why did you choose it?
Education is a top priority for me in this campaign. I think that, like I said before, we need to address the funding inequities and provide a more sustainable stream of funding to fully fund basic education for our students. And as part of that, I would also like the legislature to help to close the educational opportunity gap. Children of color and people from low-income communities, students have difficulty and lag behind in graduation rates, and I think that we really need to work on making sure that people are having the supports that they need to arrive to school prepared for success, and we really need to have increased equity in making sure that we're serving families and supporting health care, mental health, family support, so that kids can all be successful no matter where they come from.
Thank you. Candidate Van Werven, you're the first to give your closing statement.
Well, thank you again very much for this evening. One of the things that I am most proud of is my work on the Higher Education Committee and how we were able to provide a historic tuition reduction for college students. And this has made a big difference. At Western Washington alone, 20% reduction means $1,000 in tuition reduction. And I had a most wonderful thank you card from a student named Clayton, who said that this was the equivalent of a scholarship for him as he attends Washington State University. So I'm proud of the fact that we were able to do that without raising taxes. I'm also very proud of the fact that I've been appointed to serve on the Task Force for Human Trafficking. This is a very big issue in Washington State, in our district in particular, because of the Canadian border crossings. And so finding solutions to rescue women out of this sex traffic trade has just been one of the things that has been the most meaningful to me. And I look forward to going back to Olympia, finishing the job that I started. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And candidate LaClair, your closing statement.
I'd like to thank all of you for the opportunity to speak with you this evening. As you heard, I am very supportive of education, increasing economic vitality and job creation. I'm also supportive of a woman's right to choose and having access to reproductive health services. I think that it's really important to support all people to be successful, no matter what their background is. I have a lot of experience in public policy and serving the diverse needs of our community. I am a very open-minded person, willing to listen to people from all backgrounds. As far as the solutions, I think that the best solutions come from the people that are in the community, and I would like to reach out and make sure that we're serving your needs and your expectations of your government. So thank you for the opportunity this evening.
Join me in thanking both of these candidates. And if Vincent Bai and Tracy Atwood can come forward. Candidate Byes and candidate Atwood, if you want to come forward, please. These are our candidates for the 42nd Legislative District, Position 2, Tracy Atwood and Vincent Byes. The same ground rules apply, of course. We'll be starting with 1 minute opening statements. Since candidate Atwood won the dice toss and chose to open first, we'll start with you, candidate Atwood.
Good evening, and thank you, to the League for hosting this wonderful event. Everyone who wants works. Everyone has a right to learn K through 12 and beyond. Disabled individuals and those who suffer from mental health issues have a right to safe and proper intervention. Everyone deserves a voice in their lives and the things that might affect them or their loved ones. I've spent a lifetime trying to instill these values in others, during which I've seen the struggle families face with jobs, education. I've experienced firsthand the struggles of our mental health system as a family member, caregiver, and friend. There is an urgency to do everything we can to protect our water lands, and I want to encourage sustainable job growth and see that our hardworking families are paid a livable wage. This is why I'm running for state representative, to protect our voice, values, and rights.
Thank you. Candidate Byes.
Well, thank you and good evening. And I know it's getting late, but thank you for slogging through this. And I get the pleasure of being the last of the candidates up here. Our group gets the pleasure of being the last and hearing all the great questions out there. Thank you to the League for hosting this and for everybody again for being here. My name is Vincent Byes, and it's been an honor and a privilege to serve the last 3 years, 6 years, 6 years as your state representative. It's amazing how quickly the time goes by, and it takes that much time just to start understanding so many of the issues. As legislators, we're asked to not only know about agriculture and construction in my in my instance, but also about education policy, about healthcare policy, about industrial policy and economics. So it's been an honor and a privilege to take our values from Whatcom County to the legislature down in Olympia and work on those issues for youth. Thank you.
Thank you both. Candidate Byes, we'll start the first question with you. Reducing or eliminating exemptions on certain taxes has been suggested as a way to provide at least some of the $3.2 million needed to fully fund our public education system. What's your view on that?
I think it's an interesting conversation that we've had. When we look at the tax exemptions that we currently have in place, we have to recognize that the last 30 years we've had a Democrat-controlled legislature, including a Democrat governor, and every one of those tax exemptions that's been passed over the last 30 years has had to be signed by that governor. One of the also interesting things is it just depends on if you're a proponent of the particular issue or not, if it's a tax loophole or it's called a tax exemption. For example, one of the big tax exemptions that I've been a big supporter of is the film industry tax exemption. And that's one I think a lot of people here in Bellingham support. I know a lot of people from the Bellingham community have come down to lobby my office on support in support of that. So that's one of those examples of a tax exemption that keeps our film industry profitable and thriving and encourages that industry to come here to Whatcom County and to Washington State. And so it's very, very important that we look at those to keep businesses here.
Candidate Atwood, we had an error in that question. Reducing or eliminating exceptions on certain taxes has been suggested as a way to provide at least some of the $3.2 billion, I said million the first time, billion that needed to fully fund our public education system. What's your view on this?
Can you please repeat the first part of the question? I got hung up on the million billion part of it.
Reducing or eliminating exemptions on certain taxes has been suggested as a way to provide at least some of the $3.2 billion. What is your view on this? Reducing exemptions.
Reducing exemptions, I think, is a way to do it. I think this conversation is, as everyone has said tonight, this conversation is way bigger than we're going to have in a couple of minutes of quick discussion. There is a big difference between a loophole and an exemption, and I think both need to be very carefully evaluated because some of the exemptions, I'm sure, may be outdated or outmoded or just inappropriate, and there will be some loopholes that we will find along the way that we can close. And that does provide a good measure of that $3.2 billion.
Okay, you have 45 seconds to raise your point, Candidate Byes, your challenge.
All right, thank you. Could you give us an example of some of the loopholes that you'd like to see closed?
I would love to do that. At this point, I do not have any specific examples. This is a subject that I would definitely recommend that all of us get into in a much deeper fashion and find those loopholes and get them shut down.
I appreciate
it. Candidate Atwood, do you think our current education system is making Washington students ready for college?
I do not feel that we are adequately preparing all of our students for college. There are certainly some students that excel. There are some students that get left behind. And not too long ago, back earlier this summer, actually, I was talking to some students at BTC and Whatcom Community who felt that they were underprepared for the reality of what they were going to face. They felt that some of the Whatcom students felt that they were not adequately knowledgeable of the material that they were coming into and expected to know right off the bat. I would love to say that yes, we are absolutely taking good care of our students, but unfortunately, there are some that fall through the gaps.
candidate Baez, do you think our current educational system is making our Washington students ready for college?
I don't, and it's especially evident when we see that the rate of students that come directly out of our high schools and go into our community and technical college and have to take remedial education classes is, I believe, about 60%. And so that means that they're coming out of our K-12 system already not prepared just to do college-level curriculum. However, throwing more money at the problem, even as the Supreme Court has said in the McCleary decision, is not going to solve that problem. There has to be a lot of systemic changes that happens. And as Atwood said, part of the problem is, some school districts are doing a great job. Some are not able to do that. And that's one of the things that we need to address. And that's one of the aspects remaining on the McCleary decision is the local funding mechanism of how we've used those local funding dollars as opposed to the basic education being funded by the state.
Thank you. Staying with you, candidate Baez, what single legislative act do you believe would do the most to help the agricultural community maintain and enhance its crucial value to our state, and why do you choose that option?
So one of the biggest problems that we face with here in Washington State is called Western Water Law. So there's Eastern Water Law, and when you get on this side of the Mississippi, we get into Western Water Law, and it has a provision called use it or lose it. And if you have a water right, you have to put that water right to beneficial use, or otherwise you lose it. And so right now our farmers face a situation across the state where if they maybe don't need all that water for a particular year, or in this case for 5 years, they risk losing that property value of that water right. And so in order to not lose the value of that water right, they are forced to consume that entire water right. That just doesn't make sense. And so we got a great opportunity for conservation if we were to get rid of that use it or lose it provision and allow them to conserve that water that they don't need or to transfer it onto other property where they may not have a water right. And so we've been looking at a lot of these discussions, and I think this is something that can have bipartisan support because not only does it protect the farmers, but it also protects the environment through conservation.
Thank you. Candidate Atwood, what single legislative act do you believe would do the most to help the agricultural community maintain and enhance its crucial value to our state, and why do you choose that option?
Well, I absolutely agree on the use it or lose it act. It's a tough impairment on our agricultural community, and it does drive them to use the water instead of conserve it. But at the same time, I feel that with the upcoming CAFL permit, we need to provide some legislation to help the newly impacted agricultural industry offset some of those regulations. They are a huge resource in this state. We are one of the largest agricultural communities in the country, and we can't let those individuals falter because we want to protect our environment this way.
Okay, thank you. I'll have you lead off this time, candidate Atwood. Both of you have volunteered for nonprofit organizations that serve those in need. Has that affected your perspective on the role of government in providing social services?
Absolutely. Working with nonprofits and individuals in need, you get a very clear picture of the shortfalls of those services and the individuals that they help. In budgeting, national, state, local, the unfortunate reality is a lot of times when there's a budget shortfall, one of the first things that happens is we cut funding to social programs, and it directly impacts these nonprofit organizations trying to help others. We absolutely need to take a look at that and figure out how to reverse that trend.
Candidate Baez, both of you have volunteered for nonprofit organizations that serve those in need. Has that affected your perspective on the role of government in providing social services?
It absolutely has. One of the things I see in the work that I've done down in Haiti is that throughout different crises that have happened in that country, USAID and the U.S. government, in its role of compassion and what, doing what we can, unfortunately, we don't look at the unintended consequences. So we flood the country with agriculture supplies, the food that they have to eat, but they're an agrarian society. So we completely decimate the agriculture industry and what most people in that country rely on for their daily sustenance, and that's, you know, for their daily job, and that's to farm. And so we have to take a look, and if we're going to do things out of compassion, we need to make sure we look at the unintended consequences. Locally, you know, what some of the great opportunities that we have with our local nonprofits is they can actually address some of the need when they're not taking government funds. But sometimes taking the government funds makes it so they're unable to address all the needs that have to be addressed in order to get those people stable.
Candidate Buys, do you support automatic voter registration? Why or why not?
I don't support automatic voter registration because I think it has to be something that we take seriously as individuals, and we, in order to take something seriously, you have to be proactive at it. Right now, we've got the best system, I would say, in the world for making sure that people go and register to vote. We had a bunch of college students that came down when I was serving on the General Government Elections Committee talking about how we need to increase voter opportunity or registration opportunities. And I said, how many of you have a Facebook account? And every one of those college students raised their hands. I'm like, did you know that our voter registration system is just as easy as getting a Facebook account, but you have to want to do it? And so I think in order to be a good system of government, we have to be a proactive system. And if that means you have to take 5 minutes to go to the website on your own volition and sign up to vote, I think that's a good thing.
Candidate Atwood, do you support automatic voter registration? Why or why not?
I do support automatic voter registration, and the reality of it is pretty simple. Yes, it's really easy to go out and register to vote, and in an ideal world, we would all be that proactive, and our neighbors would be that proactive, and we would all be exercising that right to its fullest extent all the time. We live in a very busy world now, and even 5 minutes sometimes is a tough thing. Online voter registration, not everybody has access to a computer or a car to even drive to do the registration. We have a homeless population that is allowed to vote, that can register to vote. I've talked to a few people this year who had no idea, because they were homeless, that they were allowed to vote. Under an automatic registration program, they may not have to know. One of the greatest proponents I've seen was a student named Nico Battle. I met him this year. Incredibly smart individual, very worried that his classmates wouldn't participate in the system if somebody didn't do it for him.
Candidate Atwood, what, if any, measures to reduce carbon emissions as a means to curb climate change do you support and why?
I support the idea of reducing the carbon emissions for climate change. I do support the carbon tax to help offset some other revenues in the state that we need. I don't feel that we need to punish people or our local businesses and industries. Industries like BP Cherry Point have gone through great lengths and great amounts of money to help reduce their emissions and preserve the jobs. We need to work with them and help them do the next level and maybe even learn some things from them. But anything that we can do to offset those carbon emissions, we must do now.
Candidate Buys, what, if any, measures to reduce carbon emissions as a means to curb climate change do you support and why?
I think if we're going to address climate change, we have to take a world perspective on this. And the best thing that we can do as Washington State, as one of the leading producers of green and renewable energy in the world, is invite businesses to come to Washington State, and especially Whatcom County. We risked losing Alcoa plant recently, and Representative Werven and Senator Erickson and myself were very instrumental in making sure that they stayed here. Because if that plant goes out, all the aluminum that goes into our aircraft, that goes into our fuel-efficient vehicles, is going to be coming from China. And it's going to be coming from plants that do not use responsible technology in refining that aluminum. And so they're going to have a much higher carbon footprint per pound of aluminum, if you want to look at that, than any business in Washington State. So let's make sure that our plants, our solar industry, let's make sure they're built here, not just sourced from China and assembled here, but let's make sure they're built here, because those components can be built with the lowest carbon footprint if they're built here in Washington State.
Okay, your challenge, you have 45 seconds.
Just a quick question to Mr. Byes. In the state of Washington, I believe, and I will absolutely defer this to you as the leading representative here, what are the limitations on renewable resources? I believe that certain resources, such as hydroelectric, are classified as non-renewable and therefore would not be a viable industry for us to develop in a greener technology environment.
So our hydroelectricity is not counted as renewable here in Washington State. However, California can count our hydroelectricity as renewable. But when you look at the actual carbon generation, if a plant comes and locates here, like BMW plant, we have a carbon fiber facility that just located here in Moses Lake. That plant, using our hydroelectricity to produce jobs here in Washington State and parts that go around the world, will produce those body panels with a much greener footprint, because they're going to use virtually 100% hydroelectric energy versus that same plant being over in, say, the Midwest, which might be using all coal plant, or especially over on the East Coast, which would be much more the coal or natural gas-powered electricity.
Thank you. Candidate Byes, it was your turn to lead off. What can be done to make our community safer from violence, especially our schools?
I think one of the biggest things we have to look at, like Representative Van Werven said, is we need to address the family issue. When you look at our court system and when you look at our jail population, the majority, I think it's over 70 or 80% of the individuals that are incarcerated in our criminal justice system did not grow up with a father figure in the household. That has got to be something that we address. And that is not something that we can address at the state or the federal level. That has to be done at the community level, and it has to be done at the family level, and I mean the extended family and in the community. Because until we really address that lack of fatherhood or the lack of a father figure in the lives of many of these individuals, we're going to have this continual problem.
Candidate Atwood, what can be done to make our communities safer from violence, especially our schools?
I think family is important and education is important, and regardless of a father figure, mother figure, two father figures, we do need to bring families together, because that sense of safety in the community builds the community, helps prevent these kinds of things from happening. We also need some early intervention for at-risk, particular youth in schools. We need proper training for the people that would interact with these young people to recognize when they might be to the point where they need that intervention, even if that person has not come forward yet and said they have a problem or they feel that something's wrong. This will absolutely go a long way. Maybe not all the way, but a very long way to curbing this issue.
Okay, thank you. Candidate Atwood, what ideas do you have to help ensure that justice is colorblind?
Job creation is a big one. We must, families with jobs, families that don't have to worry about money, their children, tend to do better, both in education, through their education, in their own careers. This certainly mitigates some of the struggles that would drive especially targeted families of color, families that are already kind of a statistic in this unfortunate world. You give them the means to make them equal and bring them up in the same pay, same education, and statistically, they become a non-statistic and do far better in the world.
Hey, candidate Bies, what ideas do you have to help ensure that justice is colorblind?
So a number of years ago, Representative Jay Rodney from the 5th District, I believe he is in, he came up with what basically set up and established law, I just blanked on the term, the law advocacy centers or justice advocacy centers at the state level. And what those centers do is they really look at providing those legal services, legal aid to underrepresented communities or underserved communities or the poorer communities. And so that's a great opportunity, and I've been supportive of that and looking at making sure that we have those systems around. Unfortunately, when we look at the policies that we develop in Washington State, just about every policy has some racial component that's attached to it, where we're looking not at, is this person hungry, is this person homeless, but we look at, is this person a minority, is this person of this ethnic group or of that ethnic group, and I think that's wrong. We need to look at these programs and these policies and say, is this person poor, and help them.
Continue with you, candidate Bies. Please share with us a time when you had a conversation with someone who had an opinion very different from yours, and it changed your perspective.
This is actually the same question that you asked me at the last forum. And so I'll give the same answer because it's still very fitting. And that came when a constituent from our district approached me about hemp legislation, and I was very, very hesitant about it. And I heard warnings from other people that had talked to her, and so I sat down, and I talked to her, and she was able to convince me. And in fact, I was able to run the first hemp legislation in Washington State, which basically required that the Department of Agriculture does a study to see the viability of feeding hemp seed and hemp oil to commercial livestock. And then, if the study comes back with a positive conclusion, then we would allow that to be fed, especially in our chicken and poultry industry. And so that was a huge deal. And then I was also sponsored and was a big proponent of the actual hemp legislation, which we got out last year, which allowed a university to do research and then us to grow the hemp, not just feed the seeds.
Hmm. Helped you with that question. Yeah. Candidate Atwood, please share with us a time when you had a conversation with someone who had an opinion very different from yours, and it changed your perspective.
A long time ago in another state, Ohio to be exact, I was kind of a little stubborn, a little obstinate, wanted to help. And I had a rather intense discussion with one of the great people that like to come and visit my house for, I'm still not entirely sure because we mostly argued, but they sat me down and they looked at me and said, this is not the way you do this. And it was about providing some resources for some at-risk youth that had found their way to our house. My method was to kind of go here, this is where who you need to call. And their method was come back in and say, here, let me make that call with you. And a little less tough love. It was a little bit hard to swallow, but I did, and I'm glad I did.
Okay. Candidate Atwood, the incumbent state attorney general says that if he is elected, he would propose a ban on the sale of, quote, military-style assault weapons and high-capacity magazines in Washington. Would you support such a ban? Why or why not?
Yes, I do support such a ban, and the argument that I hear most often against this ban is, well, the federal government has already long ago banned these types of weapons. I think the assault weapon, the automatic weapon portion of this is more of a affirmation that we want these particular firearms not available to the public. But also looking at the magazine limitation part of this, I have no problem with this. This has worked in California and other states. there's no real bona fide factual reason to have more than 9 or 10 rounds in a magazine for a sidearm that I'm aware of at this point. And so, yes, I would support this.
Candidate buys. The incumbent state attorney general states that if he's elected, he would propose a ban on the sale of military-style assault weapons and high-capacity magazines in Washington. Do you support such a ban, and why or why not?
I actually don't support the ban, and thankfully, he's not one of the legislators. He's the attorney general. So we've had these types of legislation come before the legislature before, and they can't even get out the Democrat caucus because there's an understanding, and here in Washington State, we have an even stricter interpretation of the federal Second Amendment, and in that the Washington State Constitution says it is an individual right to have these. So what we saw at the federal level, we had the Clinton ban, and it didn't do any good, and so Congress decided to get rid of it. And we have not seen, in fact, we've seen a decline in crime rates, and typically it's not even these weapons that are involved in those crimes. They just look scary, and so let's ban them.
We'll go to our last question, and I'll go to you first, Candidate Buys. If elected, what legislation would you make a personal priority to pass because you believe it will most benefit the people of your district, and why do you choose it?
So the biggest thing that I think we need to address right now is the issue with the Hearst decision that came out of the Supreme Court recently. This is a decision that's going to impact property owners around Whatcom County and around Washington State, and it's especially something that we need to address. And as hopefully chair of the Agriculture and Natural Resources Committee, but as the ranking member currently of the Agriculture and Natural Resources Committee, working on water issues like this is going to be very, very important to make sure that, one, under our Growth Management Act, the Growth Management Act is there to manage growth. It is not allowed to stop growth. We are supposed to take the growth projections that come from the state, and we are supposed to plan for that growth. Without the ability to develop out in the county and in the rural areas on people's own private property, we violate the intent of the Growth Management Act. And so we need to look at that, and we need to allow people to use their property and to show that there's not going to be that damage to the environment, which we'll be able to show that there won't be.
Candidate Atwood, if elected, what legislation would you make a personal priority to pass because you believe it would most benefit the people of your district, and why do you choose it?
There's a ton of legislation that we would certainly benefit from in this community. One of my top pieces that I would look at pretty quickly would be reviewing and renewing some funding for mental health services. There is a direct correlation between homelessness, crime, and the amount of unrecognized, untreated, non-intervened mental health issues nationally, not just locally, but this is a problem that would definitely help us. We want a new jail system, but our jail right now is overpopulated because we have nowhere else to put people that need mental health intervention. We incarcerate instead of intervening, and this is something that I would look at really quickly.
Thank you. Okay, we'll come to the closing statements now, and we'll begin with you, Candidate Atwood.
Every child is entitled to an equal and quality education, state-supported institutions for mental health and the disabled, equality for women, voter equality. Each of these values are safeguarded by our state constitution. These, along with so many others, are also crucial values in this election. I'm asking to be your voice to put us back on track. Representative Buys has spent 6 years derailing us, voting against minimum wage increases, voting against women's health and services, against automatic voter registration, against the prohibition of conversion therapy for minors, against same-sex marriage, and against paid sick leave. This is a trend that I'm afraid will continue if he's elected.
Thank you. And your closing statement to candidate Buys.
Well, thank you again for being here this evening. It's been a great opportunity to share a few of the differences that we share here in common, but also some of the things that we do share in common. So as your state representative, you know, I make a promise that I'm gonna continue to represent you all. And whether you are from Bellingham, from the county, whatever your political persuasion, my door is always open to you. It has been, and it will continue to be. As I said, it's been an honor and a privilege serving you in the legislature, and I look forward to going back and to continuing the work that I've done, whether it's on Agriculture and Natural Resource Committee, whether it's looking at funding our education system, whether it's looking at reforming some of the industries and some of the aspects of our economy here in Washington State, because ultimately we want a good community, we want a strong community, and we want a safe community, and it's been an honor and privilege. Privilege to support you. So I ask for your support and your vote. My name is Representative Vincent Buys, and I ask for your vote. Thank you.
Let's thank this set of candidates.
Okay, well, thanks everybody for coming this evening. And I also want to thank our league members who have volunteered for the last several months to put this forum together. Thank you.